Merci. Non, mais ça va aller. Je vais essayer de me débrouiller avec une main. Pour changer de pour changer d'application.
C'est pomme. Okay. Tab.
Ça a l'air de marcher. Interface.
Ouais, je sais pas.
Ouais. Ok. Hello everybody. My name is Mathieu Dupont de Ninchin. I'm an architect and a Blender teacher for some years. Today it's supposed to be a workshop, so I don't know if you will be able to use your computer on your knees. The idea is that I will show you the type of things I do with Blender, and then I have three cases that we will try to do together. It's simple cases, just for you to try the things I'm using in Blender. So it's not my computer, so you don't have the slides and everything, but so today we'll just see everyday tools in Blender. There is no coding, there is no add-on, there is we can do things much more interesting with add-ons like SphereChalk, with parametric modeling, with Python, but today we'll just use see how to use the basic tools to design some funny things in Blender. So we'll not design a real building because we have no time. We'll just see how to model some strange shapes. And the idea is what I'm teaching to the architectural students in a school in France is to design by doing. So you are not planning in your head or by sketching by hand, and then you model is I'm trying to teach them how to model directly in Blender and design as if it was clay in their hands and designing. So we'll see three cases. So this is just a cube with some modifiers. So subsurf, displace, wireframe, subsurf, subsurf again. So nothing very exceptional, but it's only a cube. If you enter edit mode, it's a cube with six faces. We'll see how to design with curves, and this example, I showed it 2 years ago, I think, how you can model a parametric building and with one curve rule everything. And the last one is how to design shapes with the soft bodies, using it's inspired by Gaudi, a Catalan architect. That is using this technique, he used this technique to design Sagrada Familia in Barcelona, and I used it to teach modeling in the School of Architecture. And what is interesting is that it's a very old technique, so the mathematics that you have behind is this curve, it's written very small, but is called a chaînette in French. It's the curve that takes a rope when you, and it's a curve that is stable under its own weight. So if you put it back upside down, you have an arc that doesn't need mortar or glue and stay together. And Gaudi used it to design this this Sagrada Familia and other buildings, and to draw, he made a model with thousands of ropes and small bags to simulate the weight that was on the pillars and things like that. And he made a very big model, only done by ropes like that, and with a mirror under, you can see the building upside down. What is nice with Blender is that you can say the gravity is upside down, or you don't have to use the mirror. And what is funny too is that 3D printing with filament printing, as every layer is on the top of the layer that is under, this type of shapes is very easy to print after. So what I like is that if you design something this way, you don't need support to print it after. So you will see I have some examples here. So this type of shapes is not really up to date. It was Okay, it's more like 70s or 60s shapes, but it's still funny to do. So this is designed in Blender in 5 minutes, and we'll see how to do it. Okay, no, it's not finished yet. I just have to understand how this thing is working. So just a few videos of things I do. Control click. Yes. Okay. So this is a pedestrian bridge for a competition, an architectural competition that I lost, of course. If not, I would not be here. And this is again basic tools, but a lot of basic tools. Basically, is a plane with array modifier, longer curve. And this plane is used with a Boolean modifier to cut slices in a shape. Okay, it's only 2 minutes, so we can watch it a little bit more. So you need a very, very powerful computer to use that. One of the problems with the modifier is that they are calculated on only one thread. So even if you have a 6-core computer, it's quite slow, and it's very memory intensive. So this is not real time anymore. If you move one shape, you have to wait for it. So I'll go a little bit faster. We'll see, we'll design something more or less like that. Who has a computer here? And who has battery? If not, you will just look at how we can do it. But if you have a computer, it would be nice if you would try to do it at the same time. I will show you the other ones. So this is a 100% Blender, except the guys, the small guys that are imported tell me more. No, I don't want to hear more. So it's control. Okay, we'll see a little bit how to do that. So there is one mesh that are the floors, and I use a shrink wrap modifier to make the structure on the glasses wrap around the floor, so that if I change the shape of the floors, all the walls adjust, and then there is a when you want to put one object on each vertex of the dupliverts. There is a dupliverts for all the junctions here. Okay, just a basic cylinder. And with a dupliverts, it will put one cylinder on each junction, so that you can change, if you change the shape of the floors, the shape of the building adapts to it. So once again, it's only usual modifiers, but used in a maybe not so usual way. So it was just to try to see how you can use Blender to model. You don't have the idea yet. You just try the things in real time to see how it's moving or it's adapting to your design. Next one, and we will be almost done. I think it's this one. Yeah, I'm getting better with at the end of the this one we saw it already, so sorry. I'm not getting better at all. I think it's this one. Okay, this one is the technique of Gaudi. So you take basically you take a plane and you put some soft bodies on it. I don't know how you cut the sound on this thing. Yeah. I used to have a Mac a long time ago. And you assign some weight to say to Blender what part is elastic and what part is not elastic. And Blender calculates the shape. And then I added some cell fractures so that it's more funny, it's less regular. And then at this time we didn't add the wireframe modifier. So I used the skin modifier, which was very slow, to generate all the tubes, all the framing in it. And then it's just cycle materials and a lot of rendering time. You see all the shape was designed flat, and it's Blender that adapts it. And now, for the ones that have a computer, they can take it. And I will try with this beautiful computer to show you how you can use the tools inside Blender to make some funny things. So I don't know how many will do it at the same time, just to see. Okay, so it's worth doing it. So we'll just start with a cube. Okay, we'll not make renderings, we'll not make materials, because we have no time for that today. We'll just see how to use the modifiers to have some nice things. I'm just changing the interface so that you can see. Do you manage to read the texts? Yes, I don't need to increase it. So we'll start with this cube, and we go to the modifier panel. I assume you have the basics of Blender, so I don't teach you what is a modifier, where it is, and we'll just start to add a subdivision surface modifier. And what I will use is a simple subdivision surface modifier. What does the simple modifier? It's just, where is the Z? What is this keyboard? No, I knew QWERTY and other T, but this one is QWERTZ. So, so the simple modifier will just add a subdivision, but without changing the shape, and we'll see what is the interest of this. Z is here. I will add another one, another subdivision surface, and this time I'll leave it in Catmull Clark. So what is the, why do I like to use that, is that it will do something more or less like a bevel, but not like the bevel. Bevel, you know, bevel modifier, it's making a bevel around the thing. But the bevel has the same thickness everywhere, except if you use a bevel weight that you have to give for each edge. And what happens is that when you have very small parts, you cannot do a big bevel, because the bevel will either be clumped or be very ugly. But with this combination of one simple subdivision and one Catmull Clark subdivision, you can have very tiny, tiny faces. With one hand, it will be. So if I, for example, if I shape this one, and the pseudo bevel will adapt it like that. If I try to do the same with the bevel, you will see that I cannot have a big bevel. I cannot go bigger than that because of the size of this shape. Or if I remove the clump, I will have something very ugly like that. So this is something I use a lot, and I use a lot before the bevel existed. Okay, let's do Control Z. No. Oh yes. But for now, the aim of these modifiers is that basically you will, the more subdivision you have in the first one, the smallest is the bevel. And if you want a larger bevel, you reduce this one and make this one bigger, and you can have a rounded shape very easily. Then what we will do, I will reduce this. I will just add a modifier that is called, maybe you know it, I think you know it, it's quite new. It's called the wireframe modifier. So the wireframe modifier is creating a wireframe, but a volumic wireframe with some thickness you can adjust here. But this one is quite too regular, so if you want to add some randomness to it, an easy way is to add a modifier, that is the displace modifier. When you get completely lost, you can shout at me. But this displace modifier, I will put it first to displace the basic cube before the wireframe. So to make it more understandable, I have my two subdivision surface modifiers. Then I have a displace modifier to change the shape. For the moment, it doesn't change anything because I didn't choose a texture. So I will create a new texture. And here at the top, I will open a properties panel. I go to the texture panel. And sorry, I'm not used anymore too. And here I will choose, okay, it's the, I check that it's the displace texture. And I will just choose a cloud texture, which is a randomly generated texture. And this texture will displace, I can change the strength, sorry, here, to have some randomness on my cube. And that, as it's modifiers, at any time, I can change the resolution, decide to have more faces, less, even no faces at all. But still, this is too regular. What I don't like here, because I like to design things that engineers will not be able to build after. So this is for that I call it funny architecture and not buildable architecture. So here all of the wireframe structure has the same thickness. So I want to change the thickness of each part. And as I'm lazy, I will not do it point by point. And it's not only because I'm lazy, it's because I want at any time that I can change the number of points. And for that, I will use a modifier that is very powerful, which is the vertex weight edit modifier. It's a modifier that can assign weight to every vertex. And what is very nice is that from the 272, you can put it at any stair of the stack of the modifiers. So this vertex weight, I will put it just before the displace. So here I have the vertex weight edit that is just before the displace modifier. And here I must first say that I have a vertex group, so I go to the edit mode. I select all the faces, it's done. I create a new group, and I will assign all the vertices, to this group. So don't, here we will use only one group for the moment, but don't forget to change the name of the groups. So I will call this place. Now that I have created this group, I can go back to my modifier stack, and in the vertex weight modifier, I will choose here that I want to change the displace to make it more easy to see. I go to weight paint. So here I see my points before the displace, and here instead of a linear change, I can choose a random change. And nothing happens, and I think I know why. I think I should put this to zero first. And nothing changed too. So now you know it's live. what did I forget? It should not change anything with the random. Maybe no. Yeah. Maybe it's easy as that. I tried it this morning in a train, it wasn't working. Yeah, but it doesn't work. Let me just see if I remove those two modifiers. I don't think so. It's supposed to work. Okay, let's say you will trust me. Just to show you, I'm not lying. where is my... Where is it? Okay. We are supposed to get that. And here, I have this vertex weight here. And everything is just as... and if I go to the weight paint mode, I see that the weight is assigned randomly because I have this, I have choose random. And then after this weight paint, a vertex weight modifier, I have the wireframe modifier that use as a thickness information the vertex group that is changed by the vertex weight modifier. So it's for that in that case that is working. I think it's because it's a Mac, it's for that. So here you can see that every wireframe shape has a different thickness. But just if I enter edit mode, this is still my cube. Okay, I just have six faces, and from the six faces I can generate things like that. So I'm annoyed. I'll try to do it again. So I enter edit mode, I create my vertex group, I assign every point to the vertex group. I add a modifier. We'll start with the vertex weight edit. I choose this group and I choose random here. And now, okay, here it's working. So don't ask me why, but because not so long ago, I think until 271, you had to put this weight modifier at the first. So you had to apply any subdivision before, and it was very annoying. And I just discovered this morning in the train that now with the 272, it's working, but maybe it's not yet working at every time. But okay, so now if I put this wireframe modifier on it, okay, now it's removing it. I don't know why. And I choose here group. I go back to object mode. And you say that if you add a modifier after... Okay, so... But at least it's working on the 272 on a Linux Mint. And even on this one, you have seen it. I will go back to my example so that at least it's working. I think it was here. So I cannot put the window full screen on the Mac. The only thing that is different here is that the so here you can see the texture I used for the displays. So it's so I have my modifier subsurf. I have the displays here. No, it's not the correct one. I have the displays. After the displays, I put the vertex weight. And after this, I put the wireframe. And what is interesting in the displays modifier, that is, with this screen, we don't see a lot of things. Is that I, as a texture coordinates for the displays modifier, I like to use an object, which is an empty, so that you can grab the empty. So this empty defines where and how is applied the texture. This Voronoi texture we can see here. So what is nice is that you can move the empty and it will move the texture, but you can scale it too, and we'll see later on another example what's the use of this. And you can rotate it. So even this type of thing, even on a low computer, it's almost real time. The next examples we'll see are a little bit more complicated and slower. Something you need to know if you don't know it is this thing here that allows you to pin. So here, if any time that I select my empty to move the texture, I don't see anymore the modifier panel, so I have to select back this. So you pin this so that even if you select the empty, you still have the panels of the modifiers here. So I can move my empty to change the shape until the shape is the way I like, and then you sell this very, very expensive, and you try to find an engineer that wants to do that, and good luck. So now we'll see the next example. So next case, what's time? Everybody managed to do it or nobody? Did it work for some people, this weight modifier? Yeah. Yes. And in the wireframe modifier, yeah. you said to use the group.
Yes. No.
Then there is something the two things you can change here is the thickness. The maximum is one, so this one will depend of the scale of your object. So if you use a relative thickness, it will not depend anymore of the scale, and it's much more easy to use. Never use even thickness, because very often it will make some very strange things. And here, the factor will allow you to... You see, if I put factor to zero, it will go from very thick parts to very thin one. And if I make factor bigger, it will... this one will say the minimum amount of thickness. And then the other thing is that I added again, because normally you should have something like that with the thickness, with the wireframe modifier. And then after the wireframe modifier, I add again a subsurf simple, and then a subsurf Petmull-Clark to have this these soft edges here. The empty is for the displace modifier. the displace modifier, you have to create a texture. So we'll see the displace after to make very nice displacement, like on this model that I can give to you. Make it so the inside part is all generated with displacement. So you have to create a new texture, and in the texture panel you will choose which type of texture. We'll see that more in detail after. And then here in the texture coordinate, by default is global, and if you choose object, you can choose the empty here, and then you can use the empty to assign the position, rotation and scale of the texture. Okay, sorry. This one should not be here. Oh, forget it. We have no time to see it. So I have a first subsurf. So basically I have a cube. Okay, this cube, on this example, I just use one subsurf with two levels, just to add some division. Then I have the displace that will just give some randomness to the shape. So I will just remove all of them so that you can see it by order. So I have my cube. Yeah. This is my cube. I add a subsurf to add some division. Then I add the displace. The displace that is based on a cloud texture. To add some randomness. Then I add the vertex weight edit modifier that will randomly generate the vertex weight. This is because I want to use this weight to assign the thickness of the wireframe modifier. Then I have the wireframe modifier that will give this shape. In the wireframe modifier, you can, by default, you have replace original that is ticked. It means that it will just remove the original things and you will have only the wireframe. What is very nice is that if you untick this one, it will keep the original one. And here you have a material offset. So that, okay, it will be too slow on this one. But if your object has two materials, for example, one glass and one metal, you can have automatically the faces, the original faces that are in glass, and all the structure that are in metal. And then to make the wireframe more beautiful, I add a first subsurf modifier that is simple, and then a second one. Why is if I don't put the first one, if I just use one subsurf modifier in Catmull-Clark, I have this type of shape. So it's just a matter of taste. If you like roundy shapes, you will use only one subsurf in Catmull-Clark. But if you want something that is less roundy, I don't know if this one is English, but you put a first modifier that will subdivide your wireframe and then make the, you see, if I don't have this one, it's something like that. If I put this one, it's something like that. Yes, but I'm planning for the future, so when my printer will be a little bit bigger, we will not need any more engineers to design this. It will just print. So we will have no time to see it because the time is nothing. But what is very nice with the vertex weight is that you have another one modifier that you can play with later on, which is the vertex weight proximity. So this one will do the same. You can assign a weight to every vertex of your mesh depending of the proximity to another object. So to show you what it can do, no, it's not this one. Maybe, okay. So with this one, I just use a displace modifier. Just okay, let's forget this one. Let's it's pins, thank you. Yeah. So here basically this is my object. So it's just a column. It's a cube with control R, okay, loop cut, and that's it. And this cube, I put a vertex weight, but this is not the same, it's the vertex weight proximity sensor. So this one will assign a weight depending a weight on one vertex group, so I have to create a vertex group. And then I have a target object, which I call sol plafond, which means a floor roof in French, which is this object. So this object is just one plane, two planes in one object. It's quite slow. Okay. So the weight, if I go to the weight paint mode, you see that the weight of my points, I will remove everything that is after the weight paint, so that the weight, where is it? It's here. I remove this one too. Okay. You see that the weight of the every vertex of this object is depending of the distance. You can choose distance to the object, which is the distance of each vertex to the origin of the target object, or distance to the geometry. And here I choose face. So for each vertex of my column, we will calculate the distance to the face, the closest face of this object, and it will assign a weight depending of this distance. And here you will say you have when the distance is 7 Blender units, you have a value of 0 of weight, and when the distance is 0 you have a value of 1. And you see that the closest I am the, and if I go to, if I move my object, with one hand is not that easy. Okay, I move my object, I put it here, I go back to vertex to weight paint, and you see that it's adapting. So then after, I just put it a displace modifier along normal that depends of this vertex group. So the closest I am to this part, the more it displaces, because the bigger is the weight. So now if I move this, you see that it adapts in real time. And to make it funnier, I add some, it's with a noise texture, so you have some randomness. But with this type of thing, you can create shapes that adapt to the surrounding. For example, you can make a building, and if you include the building inside other buildings, it will stick to the other ones, or get closer or higher if it's closer to another building, and things like that. And then it's, once again, it's okay, I put it some remesh to make it like that, on the wireframe and things like that. And now you have something that can adjust itself to the surrounding. So that's it. So next case, yes? You choose it. It's here in the rolling thing is inverted compared to my computer, so I'm always lost. Here you choose in the vertex weight proximity modifier you choose the distance. If it's to the object, it will be the distance to the origin of the object. And if you choose geometry, it will be the distance either to vertices, to edges of the target, or to the face of the target. So here, it's for that I use two planes, so that I have only faces, and it's easier to manage it this way, for a simple example. So maybe it's easier to do that in Python, but I don't know Python, so I do it this way. So now, as time is passing, we'll see this Gaudi things, because it's not that complicated. What is complicated is to manage to have a shape that you like. It's like many things in 3D. It's easy to make funny things. It's not that easy to achieve exactly what you wanted. The only thing is that you have to convince people that the funny things you obtained was exactly what you wanted. And then it's so basically, it's not very complicated. You had a plane. And in edit mode, to make it simpler, we could use a subsurf modifier again, but I would just subdivide it. And you subdivide it several times. So here I subdivide it. I don't know. It depends on the power you have on your computer. So let's put 8. You have to create a vertex group to say to Blender which part will be stick to the ground and which part will be elastic. So we go to the edit tab and create a new vertex group. Always remember to give names to your things, like I say to my students. So let's call it elastic. And we assign all of them like that for the moment. So if you are not, if you want, you can go to white paint to see the colors. Okay. So here, as we have not many paints, we can just go here. I never remember, so I will just cross my finger. When it's 1, it will stick to the ground, and when it's 0, it will be elastic. Let's see. And be sure it's the opposite, but so I will assign everything to 1. I go to top view. And I will select the center ones. And I will put them to 0. So now if I go to white paint, I see that the middle ones have a weight of 0 and the outer ones have a weight of 1. Okay, let's make it funnier. Somebody's told me when I started Blender that Blender you use one hand on your keyboard and one hand on your mouse.
That's not when you use a Mac. When you use the Mac, you have to use your
feet. So the second step. Thank you. So you go to the physics tab and you will add to this object a soft body. So soft body, it's a modifier. In fact, you will find it in the modifier panel here. But all the settings are in this tab here. So you have a lot of numbers. I don't understand anything to them, but some of them I know they do things and some of them they don't do anything. So here in the soft body cache, you will choose for how long it will simulate things. So here, by default, it's 250 frames. It's enough for us. Here in the goal, it's here you will say that you want to use the vertex group elastic that we just created. Okay. And now, you just have to launch the animation with Alt A and wait that nothing happens because I'm not at the first frame, sorry. And if you play the animation with Alt A, you see that the shape is deforming in real time because it's quite easy. So how can we make this better? So today I'm lucky because it was one to stick to the ground. And first thing, I cheated in the scene here, in the scene panel, you can change the gravity. Maybe you know that on Earth we are attracted to the ground. So the gravity is -9.81 in Z axis. So you can change it to +981 so that the gravity go upstairs. Here you have some dumping. You can adjust the dumping so that it will move for less time and stabilize faster. And here in the edges, it's here basically you will adjust the elasticity of your things. Stiff quads, it means that for every quad face, it will add some springs in the diagonals of the quads. If not, you will have no springs, so your square faces, they can go like that, completely like that. So it's better to have something that it's quite more realistic to have stiff quads. And here is the strength of the elastics in the pull when you pull it and then when you compress it. So if you want it to go higher, you can put 0.1, for example, and here 0.1, and you see that it starts to go higher. If you make it very, very elastic, it will go much higher. If you want it to be like a bubble gum, you can add some plasticity to it. But with this value, it will just go forever like that. Is this plastic? If you add some value to plastic, you see that it will, it's like when you take some plastic, when you bend it after some time, it will keep its bending. Okay. If you take a metal rod, there is a domain where it's elastic. If you bend it not too much, it comes back to its original shape. If you go too far, it will not come back. It's the same here with plastic. Whoa. So then, after, it's just a matter of adding some points. And then you can put some pillars in the middle. So you go to your vertex groups, and you will say that this one is, I don't remember, it was one. Yeah, thank you. And then if I play it again, wait, sorry. If I play it again, I go to first frame and with Alt A, I play it again. Mm-hmm. This is quite strange. I don't know why. It's funny, but it's not what I wanted to have. So. So maybe when I subdivide it, it's supposed to approximate. When you subdivide, it's supposed to put the correct weight in the newly created vertices. But it seems that maybe it didn't like it. So I'll put everything to zero. I will select the four corners. Oh no, we will make it funnier. I will go to weight paint mode. I open the. I go to top view, and if you have a stylus, it's even funnier. You can paint the parts you want to be. So I want this to be fixed on the ground. And this too. And you can just have fun trying everything you want, and you just play the animation. And you see how it's behaving with these type of things. And And then it's just a matter of choosing which shape you like. So you can go in the animation with your keys, and when you like the shape, you can apply the modifier, the soft body modifier, to fix the shape and continue to work on it. But you could too use other modifiers like a solidify modifier, so that you have some thickness. Or if you don't, you could use wireframe modifier once again. So you can really do whatever you want to design things. It depends if you have friends or not, and if you want to spend your nights playing with the settings. Okay. Yeah, I think, okay, the displace modifier, basically, I had no time to show it to you. I will just show you the video while it's playing. And we will see questions while it's playing. No, it's not this one. It's this one. Sorry. Okay. Forget QuickTime. In fact, displace modifier is just a matter of spending a lot of time trying all the procedural textures and trying to understand which one makes what, and take snapshots and write, because 1 week after you don't remember if this one is a noise with Voronoi F1 as a basis and Blender as a noise as a, I don't remember the name, but a lot of procedural textures, they have two, they have the basic and they have the noise. And by mixing both of them, you can obtain very nice results. So this one is Voronoi F1 with I don't know what, don't remember. And then you have to use ramps. If you use it just with the basic colors, black and white with a blending between black and white, you will not manage to get this type of things. But once you start to add some ramps with very contrasted ramps, does it mean something to you, ramps? Yeah. Then you will manage to get very nice and funny things. All of this is procedural texture. Sorry, I have to ask you if you have questions on shut up.
Maybe quick questions? Yeah.
Have you also tried with making your own textures, image textures, and instead of procedural textures? Image textures.
Yes, you can do the same with image textures. It's just less funny. I really like to have fun with procedural textures. One limit with that is that you cannot use the node texture nodes for the displace modifier. So sometimes I use image texture, which in fact are rendered node textures, because you have much more power with the node textures, but you cannot use it for the displace modifier. So I use the node texture to generate a nice texture that I will export as an image and use, but you can use the displace with an image. So you could use, you can put your face on the building, anything you want. But what is nice with the procedural texture is the animation. You can animate anything, so you can animate the settings of the procedural texture to have things like that. But it works with the image, with a gray level of gray. You can use it, displace modifier, you can use it with RGB images, and you can assign one axis to each color. So the red will move the vertex to the X, blue to the Y, and Z to the... and green to the Z. So you can use image texture in a very nice way, but yeah.
Do you use a multi-resolution quantifier for the subdivisions?
He asked me if I use multi-resolution modifiers, or no, because I'm too lazy. No, I just didn't think of it. Yeah, and in fact, it's a two or three subdivision modifiers, because with one, you are limited to the level of 6, which is not enough to have all the details. So if you want more details, you have to add two subsurf modifiers. You can use, for this type of things, you can use the displacement of cycles, which now is very powerful, very nice, but very memory and intensive. So I could not render this with 32 gigs of RAMs on my computer, because it was not enough. The problem with the displace of the rendering cycles engine is that you cannot apply it, so you cannot print it after. But you can have nicer things with the displace in the experimental settings of cycles. You can have very nice displacements, but you cannot change it to geometry. It's only for the rendering, so you cannot export it to STL to print it after, for example. It's for that I'm using modifiers on displace modifier.
The pulsing, the flashing, that's intentional, or was that artifact?
I did not hear the question.
The pulsing was because I rendered this in several passes because it was too long, so I sent one part of it on one computer and one part on another computer, and I made a mistake between the two of them. So I don't have the same lightning. So every once in a while, I have an image that comes from another computer with another setting. So it was not intentional, and I hoped nobody will see it. But
it's a procedural rendering.
Yes, we can see it like that.
Last question.
Do you usually use sculpting or always modifiers? On your workflow, do you usually use sculpting as well, or just procedural modeling?
I would really love to use sculpting, but I never managed to have nice things. I'm too bad at sculpting. So I even bought a tablet, a computer to try sculpts. But no, I managed to have things that are quite nice. But I'm not as happy with sculpting than I use a lot of sculpting to add some randomness on some things, but more at high scales, not details. With details, I'm just bad. That's all. Thank you very much.